we've had several shows over the years in which we discussed the viability of the NBA Live series, with competitor 2K Sports seeing unprecedented success with its NBA 2K franchise. Live has been squeezed out of the market, and largely because of their own doing. Thanks for tuning into the Press Row podcast presented by Hit the Pass. I'm your host, Brian Weedy, Pasta Padre. And having first broken the news of NBA Live's delay to 2017, it hasn't come as a surprise, but what still remains is the uncertainty surrounding its future. With that in mind, I'd like to welcome in two friends of the show, Rich Grisham from Out of the Park Developments, and formerly the host of this podcast, and Owen Good from Polygon. But first, before we get to instant reactions, I think it's important to establish basically how we got to where we are now. The Live series has had a tumultuous last 6 years, to say the least. Owen, run us through some of the events that have taken place from the attempted reboot in 2010 to the potential next edition in the series now being pushed back to 2017.
It's fascinating to look back on this because, you know, Mike Wang, who still is a senior developer with Visual Concepts in 2K Sports, you know, the makers of NBA 2K, he was with NBA Live for NBA Live 10, which was a very good game and highly competitive with that year's NBA 2K10. And, you know, you look back on it, and then he was there for a year, and EA Sports, this game was then made at EA Canada. They just didn't want to go in his direction, which was a very traditional and straightforward basketball simulation. They wanted to remake it and put, you know, make the controls something like NHL, yeah. And they thought they could do it in a year, and they absolutely face-planted. And Mike went back to Novato, and it's just breathtaking sometimes to look back on that and really pinpoint when this thing went off the rails. They have not been able to get their feet underneath themselves over the past 6 years, as you mentioned. You know, that there was the NBA Elite, which is what it was supposed to be,
yeah,
canceled at the last minute. Everybody knows that story. We don't need to chew that over. They took 12 off, you know, or excuse me, 2011 off. They were going to do something in 2012, and God knows, I, you know, put a lot of time into reporting on what they were doing. Went down there, saw what they were working on. That got canceled at the last minute. They have dithered on this, and they have reinforced failures just at really every single opportunity, it almost seems. And I don't want NBA Live to fail as a product. I mean, I know that people are just going to be dumping all over it, and it's not – This is people's hard work, but there has been such inconsistency with what to expect out of this franchise, even year to year. And, you know, now here we are, they're going to take the year off of it, right? You know, they're going to take the digits off of the title.
Mm-hmm.
And that's even if the thing comes out. You know, when I don't understand why I should believe that this game isn't just going to be ash canned quietly the way previous iterations. NBA Elite, well, it wasn't quiet, but NBA Live 13, you know, was kicked down the road, and all of that other nonsense. Why that the same thing isn't going to happen to this game, it all portends that, and it's just, it's sad. That's the only thing that I can put, that's the only bow I can wrap around this, is it's just, it's a sad waste of a license to me, and of gamers, sports gamers' attention spans, to have to come into every single year wondering if NBA Live is going to come out, and then you get this kind of thing, and you're supposed to trust that it's going to be coming out in January. That's nonsense.
Yeah, and that'd be an easier time to push it back again or cancel it, wouldn't it? Late in the year.
But what are they going to gain by delaying it?
Yeah.
I mean, really, is the game really going to become that much better launching in January? I mean,
you can even look back to, like you said, NBA Elite 11, which was initially quote unquote delayed and then later canceled. And we all knew when they delayed it, it was never going to come out.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't know. Are they doing that for investors just because they don't want to announce a cancellation at a certain point in time? I don't know. They continue to invest in this series, though, and they have not quit investing in it. They put together a big team down there at Tiburon. I mean, they spent a lot of money taking a year off. They renewed their license with the NBA, so they had the intentions to continue things. And yet, you know, they're met with tepid reception from consumers and reviewers, certainly with NBA Live 14 and 15. Things warmed up a little bit this year, but consumers are not on board, no matter what, because there's another option that is 5 or 6 years ahead of NBA Live, and no matter what EA does, they're going to have trouble catching up because 2K is just going to keep building on their product, which is exceptional already, and so they're playing catch-up, and if they don't do something unique and innovative that the competition's not doing, nobody's going to jump back on. Rich, we talked a lot about Live's troubles over the last few years and what EA might have to do with the series, everything from canceling it to introducing innovative features that the competition doesn't have to switching to an arcade game like NBA Street to going free to play. So when you heard this news first off, you know, what was your initial reaction to it and what do you think it means really in the big picture?
Well, I think about it in two different ways. First of all, as a consumer, I have no problem with it. And I mean that because right now, there is no lack of great video games to play, sports and otherwise. Many sports games, particularly in the console world, have become platforms anyway. Madden with Ultimate Team, FIFA with Ultimate Team, in particular NBA 2K, have become games that the old days of where, you know, you would play a couple of seasons and put it away, are long gone. You know, there are still plenty of people like that, but the live service driven features around these games mean that, you know, they're just very different, right? So, and if you look at the release schedule and the new games that have come out and the games that aren't even new but that are 6 months old or whatever and have incredible depth and amount of gameplay in them, there's NBA Live just gets lost in the game's landscape. So as a consumer, I hear this, I'm like, cool, because now I don't have to necessarily ignore NBA Live when it comes out within the same 6 week span as FIFA and NHL and Madden and Pro Evolution. Mm-hmm. I'm personally, right, and I'm not speaking for anyone else, but I'm personally saying, Rich Christian, as a consumer, I'm happy to wait for something new, different, and interesting instead of a lesser clone of NBA 2K17, because we all know, barring some horrific misstep, which there's no indication would ever happen, NBA 2K17 is going to be another excellent experience. Whether it'll be as good as or not as good as, you know, last year's or the year before, who knows? But I mean, it's not like all of a sudden that whole thing is going to fall apart. So I'm personally fine with it. I see what they say. Sean O'Brien posted a short post today saying, hey, we're coming back with something new, different, interesting, and cool. I'm paraphrasing, obviously. I'm like, all right, it certainly sounds better than, you know, we're coming back with this fall with, you know, better dribbling and a, you know, slightly, you know, modified Ultimate Team. And I'm not even being like snarky. I mean, I'm just, right, sort of getting out of the critic world for the last 6 months and becoming in the console sports world just a consumer. I've really, it's kind of given me a different perspective on that.
But Rich, I mean, the last time they said we're coming back with something new and different and innovative, it was NBA Elite 11. And you'd be looking at a situation here where if they didn't have this already in the works well before NBA Live 16, adding on 3 or 4 months is not going to give them the ability to revolutionize the product from something that's traditional to something that is just completely new to the market and something that would dazzle consumers and get them back on board, don't you think?
But you're right, but who knows? I mean, does the announcement today means that today is the first day that they decided to go this route?
No, I wouldn't think
so. But could
so.
They have been? Could they have been within the first 30 days of release of NBA Live 16 said, you know what, guys, this isn't working. You know, let's go put some radical thoughts up on the whiteboard and let's take a step back and let's pitch something different, because I have a feeling that even if NBA Live 16 were almost as good or even as good as NBA 2K, it still wouldn't have made that much of a difference. I think the market has got its preferences. It has its history. It's got made its investment in that franchise, and it clearly
this is the value proposition that NBA Live makes to the gamer.
Well, very little, other than, and I look at myself, right? Like Pro Evolution 16 is my favorite game. I play it every day. I'm one of 8 or 9,000 people probably that play that, as opposed to the 3 million people who play FIFA every day. So that game speaks to me in a way. I guarantee you there are a few thousand people who play and love NBA Live.
I don't know about 16, that actually,
but there are hundreds and thousands or millions of people who play NBA 2K. My point is not justifying it. All I'm saying is that to a small group of people, NBA Live speaks to them, but not nearly enough to make a difference.
Well, I mean, I can find an audience for Tank, Tank, Tank on the Wii U.
That's
true. What's the value proposition to the sports gamer that NBA Live makes? And I think that it's kind of a rhetorical question, but I think it is a legitimate question. If they're trying to compete straight up with, you know, NBA 2K, how would they do that? It would have to be that it is a game that offers everything NBA 2K does and as good as it looks and just controls better. I think that would be, like, the value proposition. They can't do that because all of the effort that it would take to get the rest of the game up to that level of presentation and fidelity. So it's like, why are we even jerking around with this game anymore?
Well, even if they did, how would they convince people that they did?
Yeah,
the issue is nobody even tried the demo this year, which was a big chunk of the game, which allowed you to play online with other people in their new Pro-Am mode. Nobody even bothered with that. When I played the EA Access 10 hours, actually I used 20 hours for that, but when I was doing that, there were tops 100 people online. I mean, so even they've dug themselves a hole where they can't get out of it, even if they had a good product to offer. Mm-hmm. That's the biggest issue they face with how Live is presented right now.
And I think the market is such that, you know, unless you are the hardest of the hardcore sports gaming fanatic, NBA Live just doesn't exist for you. There's just too much good stuff. I mean, again, FIFA, NHL, Madden, NBA 2K, these are, you can argue specifics, but these are great games that are played by millions of people, and there's just not enough room for NBA. So from that perspective, the thought of, you know what, in January or February, when I've played everything already, and maybe there's something that they could do. I'm not saying it's going to happen, but as a consumer, I'm thinking, all right, well, this is better than just, you know, another rehash of a game that I know is the poor man's version of NBA 2K. From a business perspective, I think it also makes sense, right? So EA, we all know that Electronic Arts makes more money from digital sales now than from package sales. We all know that EA's mobile games are wildly successful across, you know, multiple brands, not just sports, but, you know, The Simpsons and The Sims and all sorts of stuff. So this also makes complete sense from that. Electronic Arts, I don't think, wants to lose their relationship with the NBA because nobody knows what the video game landscape is going to look like in 3 years or in 5 years. Look how different it is today than it was in 2009. It is very, very different. So 3 to 5 years in the sports video game world, it's going to look very different. I don't know how it's going to look. I don't think they know how it's look. Obviously, they have some ideas. My point is, if the NBA Live brand completely dies and they sever their relationship with the NBA once and for all, that could have larger negative implications than perhaps trying to just keep the brand alive by trying something.
Well, that's what they're going to do with this mobile title. I mean, I don't think anybody's suggesting that they're going to completely get out of it. And I think that they can make money off of mobile because, I mean, I don't play NBA 2K on mobile. I know that they have a mobile, you know, game out there. And it's, you know, it's as Byzantine as anything, you know, with a touchscreen. They can sustain their relationship with the NBA in any number of ways. Why do they choose to continue making a console game is my question.
Right.
Because it is all kinds of sunk cost that is just not paying off. I mean, it is not even paying off in a reputational basis.
That's right.
And so, you know, they'd be better off with, you know, the NBA Jam, you know, IP. They'd be better off, hell, and I kind of joked about it, you know, give us NBA Ballers again. That was a
It was
a midway game. I mean, sure, I'm sure that's out somewhere in the atmosphere. They could pick that up for a song and do that all over again.
Virtual reality, Owen. There's your new virtual reality.
It's just a valid remaster point. I mean, yeah. I mean, everybody wants to see MC Supernatural again, of course. But, you know, why do they continue with live? That it gets back again to what I was, you know, asking you was, what is the value proposition that it's putting out there? Because people have just flatly rejected
simulation
basketball from Electronic Arts.
Yes,
and
they
continue to maintain that license. They don't have to make NBA Live to maintain that license. They made a Facebook game for Major League Baseball, you know, that maintained that license. I don't know if it's still in effect. God, who plays video games on Facebook anymore?
Yeah, it's long. But my one, you know, comment to that is that if they did specifically use the word console, right? Sean O'Brien said we are committed to console. So unless that is a flat out lie,
they're always committed until they're not.
Well, right, of course, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah,
right?
I mean, NBA Elite showed that.
Right. My point is that if they are committed to the console, I think that there is going to be a continued shift in the console space. I think Pro Evolution is going to lead it, although NBA Live might lead it, to where unless you are Madden or FIFA, you have to get your game in people's hands in other ways. And I firmly believe that this is that they have seen that you can make plenty of money by having a free-to-play experience. And I think that their NBA Live console game will be some kind of a combination of a cloud-based platform that connects mobile and console and involves all sorts of free-to-play types of options that will keep the brand alive but also offer a completely different experience in NBA than a clone of NBA 2K, because that, as you said, as we've all said, that is not happening, and it's not going to work.
The different experience it offers is simply that it's going to be free to play. I mean, let's not, you know, beat around here. If they're going to do if they do what you suggest, they're going to do what Konami is doing, which is make a game that no one cares about and is out there for someone who is just sort of casually interested and wants to get in on something at a very low cost and won't sink a lot of time or investment into it. And then they'll make their margins off of the very small percentage of those who do or who do choose to do it. But to, you know, the mainstream sports gamer, the majority of the audience listening to this podcast, it won't be a game like Pro Evolution Soccer going forward that people pay attention to. Hmm. You know, so, but don't, you know, I mean, let's not talk about this being a new experience. It's not going to be that.
Yeah. So let me talk a little bit about mobile, because this is part of what EA Sports said. You know, instead of NBA Live releasing this fall on consoles, they're going to continue to focus on their new NBA Live mobile game. The actual quote was, our focus this year is to deliver an amazing, high-quality basketball game to a global audience. The best way to do that is through the fastest growing, largest, and most accessible gaming platform, mobile. And when I read that, what it says to me is, this is where people are willing to try our game. They're not going to buy it on consoles anymore. So we're going where we can actually make money, and that's on mobile. And the timing's interesting, because earlier this week, Owen, you brought up Konami, but earlier this week, they reported on their fourth quarter, and their revenues and profit were up in their last quarter over the previous year. Now, this NBA Live mobile game actually came out in February on the Canadian iOS and Android stores. I reviewed it. I thought it was actually surprisingly good. Now, it's based off of the Ultimate Team concept. It's free to play. Potentially, you're going to spend money to get packs and of cards and all of that to build up your team. And although I think the most I spent was $5, and I've got an amazing team, it happened pretty organically. But the biggest issue for me was that the gameplay was good, but it was super easy. There was no challenge to it, and hopefully that's something they're addressing, because it's still 3 months later, and they have not rolled it out beyond the Canadian iOS and Android stores. Now, if you want to play it, you can do so by creating a Canadian iOS account, downloading NBA Live Mobile, or you can download the APK for Android and sideload it. So there's ways you can play it now if you want. But you know, I was just thinking recently, it seems like a missed opportunity considering that the playoffs are going on and all the excitement around that. But I gave an 8 out of 10 for Sporting News because it really showed a lot of potential. And the user reviews are on iOS are 4 stars. There's a ton of reviews there, and 4.5 stars on Google Play. There are a ton of reviews there. So there's potential with that game. But, of course, it's not a game where mobile in general is not something we're completely passionate about. But there's certainly successful games there. Madden NFL Mobile, FIFA Ultimate Team. Those games are doing well there, and plenty of, a handful of other games. So do you think this is a smart move for EA to concentrate on mobile, particularly, Rich, with a struggling franchise like Live?
Absolutely, because it may be the only way to keep it alive, right? So let's say, for example, that Electronic Arts wants to have a viable competitor on the console basketball simulation space, right? Let's say that remains a goal of theirs. Well, one way to make that happen is to earn revenue in a mobile game and buy your development team time for 18 to 24 months to do what you would want to do to really significantly upgrade your game. That may not make a whole lot of people happy, because they're going to miss a couple of years of a game. But on the other hand, we know that very few people are buying this game anyway. So if the revenues are generated from a mobile game and then you're able to either funnel some of that back into the R&D on a console game and or at least, you know, keep the lights on and keep your brand alive and share some of the assets and the IP and the player likenesses and stuff like that, I think that's a great idea. It's certainly a better idea, in my opinion, than cranking out an inferior game every year with a very short development cycle and just continuing to see your sales and your, the brand quality go down.
Yeah, I think certainly that's one way to keep the name alive, although at this point maybe the name is detrimental to anything they're doing. Owen, do you have any thoughts on NBA Live just as far as surviving in the mobile space in the meantime?
I mean, that's well and good if that's what, I kind of joked about this earlier today. I said that they should just call it NBA Live Tapped Out, because EA has made a ton of money off The Simpsons Tapped Out, and that is on, that's a mobile only game. Mm-hmm. And mobile, I mean, it's not, if mobile's a flagship platform, how come, we're not talking about Mass Effect or Battlefront or any of these other games on it?
Right.
I mean, seriously, let's be very real about what these things are supposed to be doing. And so, I mean, if they want to do NBA Live on mobile, that's great. I mean, they can, it feels kind of like a con job to me, because as you said, Brian, this is the audience that's willing to try our game because the ones on consoles know what a disaster it's been, for them. And they've said, no, we're done with it. And not only has it been a disaster, it's just been so inconsistent. And the consistency is it even going to happen? And people are sick of that. Well, I'm sick of that.
Yeah, and the other reason why they're willing to try it, Owen, the difference is they don't have to pay $60 up front.
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, yeah, obviously, yeah, and it's all delivered digitally and everything else, too. A mobile title is great if they want to, maintain their relationship, but it's not my audience. It's not the people who I talk to when I'm talking about, sports video gaming. And I'm not trying to be a snob about this, but let's face facts. Mobile is a stripped-down version of the full-fat experience that you get on a console. And if mobile is some great big opportunity, why the hell is this stuff on console? Why don't we just put it all on mobile? You save yourself the distribution costs.
Well, that's where I think this is not about the short term. I think it's about the long term, right? I think Electronic Arts wants to be the platform of choice for all major sports over the course of the next 5 to 10 years, right? And they want, I believe that they feel that the way that we play games on consoles right now is not going to be the way that we play games on consoles in 3 years and in 5 years and 7 years.
People were saying that 10 years ago too, though.
Agreed. I'm not saying
it's right. NBA Live on a console at all.
What's that?
What is the purpose of having NBA Live on a console at all?
Well, they're not right now, right?
This gets back to, I don't think EA or Sean O'Brien, frankly, are telling the truth when they say that this game is coming out on a console at all.
Right. Well, hey, Owen, you remember?
I don't trust that at all.
You remember? Don't go back and look at the open letters and Sean literally guaranteed. NBA Live 16 and NBA Live 17 would be.
Oh, released. He guaranteed it to me in my home. But I'm sorry, things change.
Well, that's the thing, right? It, like I said earlier, everything they're committed to something until they're not, until the day that they're not, until the moment that they're not.
They were committed to NBA Live 13 and they pulled the plug on this sucker.
They can't approach anything without being committed to it. Otherwise, they are going to fail. The only way you don't fail is when you are committed to something.
Oh, my God. This is like Schrodinger's cat.
So another thing I wanted to hit on was that, and it was mentioned earlier, they dropped the year off. Now, maybe this changes later, but they dropped the year off. And that's reminiscent of what they've done on mobile with NBA Live Mobile, with Madden NFL Mobile. You also had Rory McIlroy PGA Tour, which doesn't have a year attached to it. You also had EA Sports UFC. So it could be that NBA Live becomes an every other year title. It could be that it's a free to play. Now, I actually called in 2014. I actually called for NBA Live to go free to play because I said, look, no one is going to pay $60 to play NBA Live. So you can't get people in the door to spend money on your ultimate team mode. The only way you're going to be able to do that is by letting them in for free. And then you might actually get more people than you would have otherwise, and maybe you actually end up making money on NBA Live instead of going in the hole even more every year. Do you think free-to-play, Owen, represents a possible path of success here for NBA Live, or do you think it's just not going to happen?
I mean, sure. I mean, it's better than nothing. I mean, but you also have to understand, NBA 2K makes a huge value proposition, you know, in the microtransaction space, which is what we're talking about here, you know, and why you should play that and spend money on the extra stuff that you have there. I mean, yeah, you have to have a $60 buy-in if you're with NBA 2K. If they went truly free to play, you know, like what Pro Evolution has done with its free to play, you know, version.
It's a limited experience.
It's a limited experience, and it's designed to funnel you into, you know, the microtransaction mode, for lack of a better term, and spend money there, obviously. And so, you know, you're not really doing things that all the other people are chattering about on Twitter about, look at my season, or look at my player, or I'm the MVP in this year, or, you know, hey, here's this crazy coach, why is President Obama on the sidelines, you know, that kind of stuff. That's not going to be, you know, in that type of a game. You know, again, I kind of want NBA Live to stop pissing on my leg and telling me it's raining. I want them to make a decision about what they want to be when they grow up and commit to that, because nobody believes that them being a traditional console game either is working, is sustainable, or is even going to happen year to year. And so, you know, yeah, sure, you know, free to play, great, that's fine. Sure, you have the architecture there, the engine, the options. Sure, you know, try something with that now if it doesn't cost too much. I have no idea what the development cost is, no idea what the margins are. It seems like there's a lot of flag planning nonsense that's going on with this. It seems like the console, in a backward way, it seems like the console game is the reputation builder that sells the mobile game, for Christ's sake. And that just seems completely inverted to me.
Yeah, I mean, mobile games have a lot of trouble getting traction, getting exposure. And certainly the big names that they carry can help in that regards. If you look at the top revenue generating mobile games, it's all from pretty much companies that you recognize and now you're seeing commercials all over the place for these games too.
Yeah, Arnold Schwarzenegger and Game of War and all that other crap. Yeah.
I mean, here's what I think. So we all know that a really good selling sports video game is a moneymaker. Right, we know that EA makes money, makes plenty of money on Madden and on FIFA. We know that Take-Two Interactive, the owners of 2K, make plenty of money with NBA 2K. So the template is there for how you can have a very profitable sports video game. EA cannot have a profitable sports video game with their NBA Live franchise. It's just not going to happen. So what I think is that at this point, they're looking at themselves, and when they discuss this game, they're probably asking the question, all right, if we can't beat 2K at their own game, how can we be, and I hate to use the term because everybody uses it to the point where it doesn't mean anything, but how can we be a disruptor? How can we just completely flip the script? Because the script, the play that we're running now doesn't work. And if they stop, if they quit, then it's over, right? When they quit on MLB, on MVP, it's over. They will never get back into the baseball space. You can't take 3 or 4 years off of making a console AAA quality sports video game and have a prayer of getting back into it.
As demonstrated by the NBA Live series.
Yeah. And if they pause, and when I say pause, I don't mean pause development, I mean pause on publishing, there's still a chance that if they can find the right model with the right game, there's still a chance that they can be a player in the space and potentially disrupt it. We have seen sports franchises on top go away, and we have seen sports franchises that were on the bottom make their way up. And the other thing is, there are very few companies left that publish video games, and there's less every day. Literally today, Disney got out of the video game publishing business. They're like, you know what? We're out. We're done. Right? Mm. So I think if it were up to me, and I don't have any of the information, but if it were up to me, I would absolutely hit pause on publishing this game. I would say, what opportunity do we have in the next 24 to 36 months to disrupt this field and to have our NBA game be a game that people want to play and that we can make a profit on? And to me, that's what this feels like. This feels like they're not throwing in the towel on the console space, but they're not yet committing to a new story because they don't quite know exactly what that's going to look like.
I think the last few years, what happened with EA is that they got drunk on their success with Ultimate Team. So why did NBA Live stick around even as it was failing? It's because they said, look at the market. It's expanded to 8 million consumers a year because of NBA 2K. If we could just get 1 million of those people in, and if we could just get our percentage that we have in Madden and FIFA that play Ultimate Team, and then the percentage of them that spend money in Ultimate Team, this can be a profitable series. But they're not reaching a million.
That's right.
They're not coming close.
Right, because you have to buy the disc game to get into
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
Right. Last fall on this show, Sean O'Brien told the story. He's like, you know what? You don't have to be number one to be profitable. And he talked about Nike versus Under Armour, right? And Under Armour only had 7 to 10% of the market, but that was enough to where they had a great business. And so that was their play. That was exactly their play. And
NBA Live is not Under Armour. NBA Live is like Kuga. Okay.
But NBA Live is under 1% of the basketball video.
Right. Game and they weren't expecting it, right? Yeah. I don't think anybody expected the, what was it? You said 8,000 copies sold in the first week versus a million. I mean, that was, I think, the catalyst to probably drive everything that we're talking about happening.
I think they have been throwing good money after bad with NBA Live for 6 years. And the frustration that you hear in my voice is not that I want this project to fail. I want every game to be good. What I don't want games to do is waste my time. Okay. You know, because money is potentially infinite. I could win the lottery tomorrow. Time, I could die tomorrow. Okay. So what are you doing with my time? And NBA Live hasn't done anything meaningful with anyone's time for the past 6 years. And that's why they need to stop pissing around with it on consoles and just commit to mobile and sit there and quit wasting our time on consoles, especially with this kind of kick the can down the road crap about coming out around the All-Star game in January. Nonsense.
Look, we all want competition in sports gaming, and the problem, though, is that NBA Live isn't competition. It does nothing unique. It does nothing that differentiates itself from the industry leader, and that means that it's just there. It's not competition. It just exists, and that's the problem we have right now. And I just want to go one more thing before we close up a bit, and that's Rich seems to think this move to January, February, March could be beneficial for it, at least for him as a consumer, maybe less so for EA, but I'm curious what you think, Owen, because what would happen is NBA Live would move away from NBA 2K, which is good in a sense, right, because it would get obliterated again this fall. But then what EA would be asking consumers to do, if this is a traditional game, is buy a second NBA game, and that scenario is hard to imagine considering no one has confidence in the brand anymore, and 2K is a strong seller all the way through June, or it's free to play, and they expect people to pay money into NBA Live when they've been doing so in NBA 2K. Do you think it can live there, Owen?
I could see them trying it as a free-to-play game and as an alternative, and they say, you know, because it is true, you know, people, you know, own, you know, with basketball, you know, the hardcore are interested in the early season, and people really, you know, the mainstream, you know, when it becomes a national conversation is spring and into the playoffs. I understand that, and I get that, but, you know, they're complete, as a free-to-play game, maybe. As an actual, you know, console game, which again is what they're leading us to believe, okay, not some, you know, slap crap free to play thing that nobody cares about. That I don't understand why you would publish that and completely skip the holiday season. Ridiculous. Putting it on the shelves, just putting anything on the shelves for the holiday season and fooling somebody's grandma because they see EA Sports. Oh, well, that's the market leader.
It didn't happen last year.
NBA Live.
Nobody bought the game. That's what they did last year, and literally nobody bought the game.
Retailers have to stock it, Rich.
Not anymore. No, EA makes more digital than they do on package.
Well, yeah, but nobody, you know, people generally aren't buying as gift a digital game. I think that's probably
spent all their money. It doesn't matter if you're getting it digital or physical. They've already spent all their money by the time it's January.
Yeah. So, right. I mean, there is one example of where EA tried this, actually. If you go back to NCAA March Madness,
yep.
So it was competing against College Hoops 2K, and they're slightly different circumstances for the college games because neither of them really sold well. But EA had this idea, hey, we'll move it to, I think it was February, or it might have been early March. It was right before the tournament when, in theory, that's when people are actually paying attention to college basketball. Sales were worse. That was a special edition
off of a full release that preceded it, wasn't it?
That might be.
I think it was.
There was one year where they released a limited, like, 64-man tournament. That was a digital release, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that was different.
There was an actual package release one year where they moved the actual release back to either late February or early March.
I feel like they have, you know, this is just the same old song, and I'll just stop there.
Yeah. So before we go, I just would like you to sum it up. This time next year, What are we saying about NBA Live? You know, considering its track record, there maybe isn't reason for optimism at this point, but we also only have what EA says right now to go on. So do you feel the game will have released in a traditional manner as a same type of product as we've had for years and years. Is there a pivot to free to play, or did it not release? Rich.
I think that there will be a pivot to free to play, and that it will be something that will come out in summer of next year.
Wow.
Yep. So I think they're going to, and again, this is not based upon anything other than,
Yeah.
I think they'll look to completely go to a free to play, potentially tied into an EA access mm-hmm. model. And that there will be something that will allow them to differentiate themselves in price, to be in a slightly different release window than the traditional console games, and attempt to reach a different new audience in a way that is not similar to trying to copy NBA 2K in content or in price.
Owen.
I agree with Rich about all of that, really. I mean, I don't think that we're getting any kind of a traditional console game, early next year, January or February. I doubt it's going to release at all. But I also think that they have any number of other options that they can use to sort of, put something out there, keep it on a back burner, and claim that they lived up to whatever they promised us today. I think mobile and free to play is where this game is poised and headed. I don't know that it's something that is necessarily attractive or a selling point for something like EA Access. I don't know. I mean, I could see it, going there. And they try to lure people in with maybe some kind of a sports package in EA Access, or they carve up whatever their subscription is in a different way and use NBA Live as a loss leader to get people into that. I don't know.
That's kind of the next way for them to go, is they have EA Access, which offers you up the vault, which is games that have been out for a little while. Now, are they going to have a subscription for games that are new?
but this, this... Trust us, we're going to give you a console game. No, that's not going to happen.
Right.
And there will not be, whatever happens, there is going to be no physical edition of NBA Live.
Well, no, I think we've seen the last of that. I totally agree with that, too.
If they were to do that, that's the last release of NBA Live ever.
Yes.
Other than mobile stuff. So I'm gonna agree in the sense that I'm sticking with the free to play idea, because I've been on that train for years now, and I thought it was inevitable. And I don't know if it'll be early next year, because that doesn't seem like a really ideal time for it to happen after the holidays. People don't have that expendable money to spend on an Ultimate Team in a game that they necessarily didn't want to begin with. But I do think we'll see something from them, which is a bit of a change for me, because I've been thinking it was more likely they were just going to cancel the series. But I think at this point, if they're going to stick with mobile, they'll probably keep the brand alive at least for one more year and see what they can do on consoles, because at this point, they don't really have a whole lot more to lose. So we've got this dramatic change to NBA Live, which was not necessarily unexpected, but we're still unsure really what it's going to mean for the series going forward. Thank you, Rich Grisham. Thank you, Owen Good. Make sure to follow them on Twitter at their names. I'm Brian Weedy from Pasta Potter. Hit the pass in sporting news. We're going to talk more NBA Live in upcoming podcasts. Not because the series is especially relevant at this point in time, but it's another possible sacrifice in the sports gaming genre that has contracted considerably in the last decade, and that's unfortunate no matter what we think of each title. Thanks for joining us for this show, and take care till next time.